time. This is a 30-minute webinar, and I am going to be talking about my 7 favorite tips and tricks for your federal application. But first, I just want to show you a couple of my blogs that I think are really good. This one just came out a couple days ago, and it was inspired by one of my clients who used the kitchen sink words. He said, "I'm still using the kitchen sink approach with my USA Jobs resume because I think that the resume is read by computers. No, 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 no." So Paulina Chen and I wrote this blog about how to improve your resume, copying the keywords. And then down here further past the beautiful place setting here, this I did an announcement analysis, and you'll have to go back to this after the webinar, because here's an analysis for a budget analyst for Justice Department. These are the duties for the job, and I featured what the keywords were. And this is the 1-year specialized experience. And drum roll, there's the keywords right there. This is how you build your outline format resume, is by analyzing those keywords. So be sure to come back and read this again later. And then I'm going to click on this link here, Hire Me a Minion. Now, this sounds kind of silly, but wait a minute, you've got to hear this. And I'll do the PowerPoint in just a second. So Paulina wrote this because she's got 3 kids, so she's minionized. Isn't that cute? They're so colorful. So here's the article. It is called Hire Me a Minion. So she's hiring a minion. And she's got to decide who she wants to hire. So there were 3 responses that came for the job, doing lighthouse work and homework and stuff. So here's Minion A. He said, he or she said, housekeeping, petting dogs, gets good grades. Okay, that's A. Then B says a whole bunch of words about whatever, minionese, this and that, and I don't feel like reading it. And then Minion C, look at this. This is our beautiful outline format that we talk about in all my webinars and all my books and every day for all my clients. So they broke it down using the hats that she wears. She's the hat lesson. She's skilled as a housekeeper, homework helper, dog walker, and she is very timely and dresses correctly. Which one are you going to hire? You know it. The first one is a laundry list. The second one is a big block of words. And the third one is basically our format that we use to write our resumes. So if you forget how to find this article, you can just click on blog and search for the word minion, and this will come up. Isn't that cool? I know. I love that. So hang on, and I'm going to change my screen, and we are going to do the webinar right now, screen 2. So I first taught this webinar in, believe it or not, 2011, but the date on here is 2012. I have a couple questions. Ted says, I filled out a number of questionnaires. How important are these for the applications? Is it really a good idea for my resume to directly address the questionnaire? Okay, Ted, that's great. That's trick number 7, so hang on for that. And Ann asks, is age a negative factor when you're applying for a job? She's 51, 52. Age is good for you, Ann. If you were 62, it would be more of a problem. 52 is fine. Just take out all the dates from the 80s in your resume. Just start with like 95 to 2014. That's 20 years. Try to take out everything before 95 so that you don't have the indication of your age at all. So just do it that way, and you'll be fine. Okay, here we go, my 7 tips. And that's me holding all my books. It's a handful, isn't it? So here's the tips and tricks. First one is a keyword story about the word resilience. The second one is about a jumping mouse story from New Mexico. And this one we're going to talk about the importance of adding a story or an accomplishment to your resume. The third one is about a veteran and a targeted resume that helped him to get hired. 4 is Schedule A. Hiring a person with a disability is so important that you be networking and be persevering. The 5th one is keywords. His resume, his original one, was all about guns and weapons. And then the 6th one is about volunteer work, how it can be used as a job block in the USA Jobs resume. And number 7 is give yourself all the credit you can with the questionnaire. And believe me, you do not want to leave this workshop before you get to 7. It could get you hired. So got your attention, don't I? Okay, first story. Here we are in Holloman Air Force Base, and this story is about this gentleman right here in the middle. And it's this is a class that I teach all over the country about, it's a train the trainer program on federal job search. So Bob was sitting in the class, and I asked everybody to find a job announcement that they could analyze during the class and we could talk about and learn and all that. And so Bob found this announcement, and he was shocked. He said, when he found it, he said, "Oh my gosh, I've been waiting for this announcement for a year. It came out today." So of course I went, "Oh wow." He said, they're hiring these resilience people in every Air Force base around the country, and I want this job." So we pulled out the duties to find the keywords, because that's my first thing when I find an announcement, besides determining who can apply for the announcement. So I read the announcement, and here we have the keywords. I have them in red. Resilience Program Specialist. Executive Director would be a leadership thing. Caring for people. Leading this organization. Resilience Preparedness. Airman Family Resilience. And then Installation Resilience. Do you get it? Do you get it, everybody? Do you see this? Do you see what's happening here? The word resilience is everywhere. And if you were to apply for a budget job, the word problem solving or metrics might be everywhere. So we've got to get the word resilience in his resume. And here is what we did for him. He hired us to help him with this resume. So this is your first look at the outline format, just like the Minion, where she had housekeeping, helping with homework, and walking the dog. Here we have leadership and resilience and readiness program knowledge. So those are the two top skills they're looking for, is leadership and resiliency. Look how many times we have the word resiliency in this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, at least 6 times. I'm not sure exactly how many. So it's very important that these keywords get into the resume to match the announcement and to focus the resume toward the position. So all cap keywords, leadership, and then resiliency. And if we go back to the announcement again, they want resiliency and leadership. Executive director would be leadership. Managing aspects of the installation for caring for people, that's leadership. Lead the CAIB. So leadership and resiliency really is totally it. Well, guess what happened? Here we go. Drum roll. Ta-da! He got the job. He got hired in 2012, which is a while ago, but still, he got hired. And he said, "This is official. I was selected this afternoon for the position at Los Angeles Air Force Base. It was based entirely on the contents of the resume with no interview. That resume was so good, they did not interview anyone. They just decided to hire Bob." And so he was very happy. And that's because the words. I worked with Ellen Lazarus, did the writing on it. And when we were working on it, I said, I made the keyword list. And I said, "Let me see that resume." And we just went crazy with it, adding the keywords in. I mean, he said, "I've been doing resiliency work in my job for a couple of years," not officially, because the resiliency just kind of came about a couple of years ago as a word and a skill and a program. But he'd been doing it. And look at all that he's been doing. So I love that story. Okay, here's another one. That's me at the Ranger Station at Lincoln National Forest. And those are all stuffed animals. And it's a really nice Ranger Station. I love to go to those places. And this is my class. This place was 10,000 feet up. And when I got hired to train there, they didn't tell me the elevation. I should always ask, what is the elevation of your training room? That is when I go to New Mexico, right? So anyway, here's the crowd. And the guy that I'm going to talk about for this trick here is the guy on the right here with the hat. His name is Chris. These are all hotshot firefighters and biological wildlife technicians, temporary and seasonal. And the boss in the middle there, the senior guy with a beard, he hired me to come and help everybody try to get a permanent job with their resume. And that was a very, very nice thing to do, because they're pretty much stuck when they don't know how to write a resume for USA Jobs. So another thing I do in my classes when I'm teaching is I ask everybody to write an accomplishment with on their pen and paper. And I ask them to write, three or four or five sentences about something that they've been working on that they're proud of, that's challenging and interesting. And so I let them write for 4 or 5 minutes, and I stand there and I say nothing. I say, pick up your pen and now start writing. And so they all did that. And Chris was over in the corner on the right with three other young people, all talking about something really important. So I thought, whatever they're talking about, I want to hear this story. So, because I'm always looking for a story to feature in the classes because this makes the classes more interesting. So he had been a wildlife technician at GS9 for 10 years. That's amazing, isn't it? He had never written any stories or projects or summaries in his resume. He brought his resume to the class, and it was just a list of the dates that he'd been working there and the name of the place, and it was nothing else, his education, and that was it. This blog is posted on my blog, so you'd be able to find it. If you search for the term Jumping Mouse Blog, you can find it. And this is what he wrote. Now, I interviewed him using my KSA builder with the CCAR, and then we edited it. And you might be wondering, so what are you supposed to do with this in a resume? Well, what you're supposed to do with this is put it in the resume, because the announcements ask that you have knowledge, skills, and abilities in certain things. And this example demonstrates that he has the ability to manage a biological study. And so this could help him get a GS9 lateral for a permanent job, or maybe even get a promotion, since he has a huge amount of experience, and I think he had a master's degree. So I'm going to read this story, and you can think about this. And when I look at resumes that come into the resume place for the free review, I look to see if there's anything that's interesting in the current job or the second job, to see if there's something that would grab my attention or the attention of the hiring person. A lot of people who come to us are current feds, and their big problem with their success in changing jobs is they don't get picked up for the interview. They can get best qualified easy because they have 1 year specialized experience at the next lower grade level, but they have trouble getting the interview. So here we go. He never wrote a story in his resume before. So, conducted research to help secure the future of the Environmental Species Act candidate, New Mexico Jumping Mouse, while serving as lead biological technician at the Lincoln National Forest. Developed the original protocol to capture the mouse from the wetland under deadline due to lawsuit over wetland water use. Led a team of 4 biologists, set out 200 traps, studied and captured 2 mice from this notoriously trap-shy species within 2 months. Gathered, analyzed, and wrote reports on data, presented findings to community groups. Prepared the final report for possibility of endangered species designation, and determine suitable habitat for future conservation. So that's a story, and that would go into job block 1 for the summer of probably 2012. That was one of his accomplishments, was this study that he managed. And this would go to the KSA, that would be the ability to lead a team, the ability to manage a biological study, the ability to research and develop for Environmental Species Act, all kinds of things the story proves. So when you go back after this and have time to look at your resume, I want you to look at your current job block and see if there's a story in there. And I don't mean a one-liner bullet either. This guy, Chris, could have written it, like he could have written the first sentence. Research a study to secure future of this all the way to the first line and stop writing. Well, then he would have skipped the original protocol, that this mouse was trap shy, all the rest of it. Those were the challenges that he faced with this study, and then he met the deadline and prepared the report. This story tells so much, and the HR people really appreciate seeing accomplishments and details. And then this is another story about trail building that another guy spoke about. He was a lead recreational technician, and he led teams of volunteers to do pick up the grounds and trails and all that. So he did an accomplishment too. I'm sorry that I can't tell you what happened with Chris, because he got another job and he probably gave me his government email and I could not contact him. But I would bet $20 he got a new job after that workshop. Same with this guy. This is a very good example for teamwork. Okay, now this is another example. This is another one of my classes. Everybody's smiling really good, holding one of my books. And this is a story about a veteran. And this is really funny because I'm going to show you his before resume. And this is a total true story. This story happened really about 4 years ago, and he gave me this resume. I asked him for his resume, and he wrote this down. He was working as a bartender at a really famous hotel in Baltimore, and he actually did write that he specializes in authentic, detail-driven cocktails. He tells me today he still makes really good cocktails. Well, that's nice. And then the job before, he was a helicopter crew chief with the Marine Corps. And the challenge for him is that he did not want to stay in aviation. He was not going to apply to FAA. He wanted to do program analyst or intelligence analyst. And this is the resume that we helped him prepare. While we were working on the resume, he joined the Maryland National Guard, and we added he did get the designation of intelligence analyst in the Guard, database administrator, training, safeguarding personal information, and operation planning. Those are the hats that he wears as in the Guard. And so then he got hired from that first, from the resume that we wrote for him. And he said, first off, let me give you a very quick thank you for a huge thank you. Yesterday was my first day at DHS, and I absolutely feel I made the right choice. P.S. He had 3 job offers. He's pretty good. And he got a promotion just last week. He got a GS-11 last week. He did the interview for it just Friday. And you know what's really, really good about this and I'll type in here this website. This website is mine as well, that fedjobs.org. If you want to see Jeremy's entire resume, you can go to that website and download it because it is there. But since he joined the Guard, he got a job at DHS, and he went to work at DHS for 3 months, and then he got called up by the Maryland National Guard for 1 year. Can you believe that? And then he came back for his job, and it was still there. And then last week, he got a promotion. So a government job for a reservist is a very, very, very good thing. Okay, trick number 4 is about Erickson, and this is really him. A while ago, 2001, he's older now. He actually has a really good job now. We helped him get hired 2 times, and he's hearing disabled. I met him at Gallaudet when I was teaching classes. His first job was with the Peace Corps, and he got a really good job there for as a deaf education teacher, and he used a bullet format for Peace Corps. And then when he came back from the Peace Corps, I helped him, and he got a job at the Smithsonian as a permanent position, a GS-7, Target 9. And he just wrote to me yesterday saying he's doing well, he's working really hard, and we should update his resume and get going. But the Schedule A system did work for him. He sent it to the Selective Placement Program Coordinator at the Smithsonian, and they took care of him and helped him to get a position there. But it did take a lot of perseverance for him to get that position. It took a year to get hired. So it doesn't happen fast, but he didn't stop trying. Now this guy, this is a funny one. I love this first resume. This is a resume he sent to me, which of course is not really a resume. I don't know what it is. It's a list of sorts. And when it came into our free estimate review service, and I was fascinated with it, and I thought maybe I should talk to him myself to find out what he wants, because, I mean, I never seen such a good list of weapons. And so I thought I should talk to him. So that is his before resume. And this is what he said. He said, I want to be an FBI special agent. I want to use my language skills. And I want to go into security. This is my career that I would like. And I'm working on my degree, and I would like this position. And this is what we wrote for him. And I just love this way that we wrote the rifleman job, that he featured 2 keywords, leadership and security. And you know, he did have some success. Now, he did not get hired by the FBI. And I have to tell you that when I get to trick number 7, his problem with the FBI application was he did not do the questionnaire right, and he did not get best qualified. And that was a setback for him to do the questionnaire. It was unbelievable when I saw it, almost fell over. But he did just get a job on Monday, believe it or not. He worked with his voc rehab person and the VRA program, and he is now at the Veterans Administration. He's a claims assisted, but he called me because he's just so happy to be in the door in the government. He wants to have an update on his resume right away so he can try to scoot over and do something in security. So I know he's going to get there. I know he is. So this resume is really good. Translates all the rifleman work, which he, you know, wrote here, and which is not relevant now for what he did not want to be a law enforcement officer. N-O, no law enforcement, but yet that resume, you know, just spoke to it. So good news. 2 days ago, this guy was hired, so I'm happy about that one. Now, trick number six is, you know, you can add volunteer work into your resume, and this is a person at Bowling Air Force Base who was a very dedicated volunteer. That's Dawn McClure, and she received the Presidential Volunteer Service Award. And the point that I want to make here is that you can add your volunteer service work into your resume as a job block. Okay, you can add it. And so that she didn't make any money in this job, but she worked there a couple years, a long time. And her keywords are advocate, separation counselor, intake assessments. The all cap keywords still apply whether you are paid for the job or whether it's a volunteer position. So here it is. And she didn't end up getting a job in D.C., but she did get a position in Texas when they relocated again in human resources. So this resume format did work for her. And here we are, trick number seven, and I'm going to spend a little bit of time here. We have 7-8 minutes. So the questionnaire, if I had to say what is the biggest, the top three problems that people have with their federal applications. Number one, resume is not in the outline format, and the resume is horrible. That's one. And that includes no keywords. Number two, no accomplishments at all. Nothing interesting, just a bullet list that you can't read. But number three is the questionnaire. It is just not, people do not give themselves all the credit that they should. And so let's read number E here. E is, I supervise the performance of the task. I'm normally the person who is consulted by others to assist them with unusually complex situations related to this task because of my expertise. So there's two ways to be an E here, supervision or I am the go-to person because of my expertise. Many of these scoring questions have three ways to be an E, supervision or I'm an expert in this task or I am the person who is consulted because of my knowledge. And a story here is I taught a class at DFAS one time up in Battle Creek, Michigan, and I was doing this little e-lecture, and somebody raised their hand in the front row, and she said, we don't have any E's here at all in this room. I said, oh, really? Why is that? She said, because there are no supervisors here. Oh, my soul, can you believe that? So nobody in the room was ever checking off E. I guess that's why I was hired to train. Because we had an E problem, nobody could get best qualified because they don't tell you this, but the questionnaire is a test. It's a test. You have to get a score of 90. You've been seeing rejection letters that might say you were found to be qualified but not among the most qualified based on the questionnaire answers. They say that. They say it right in the email that they send to you where they reject you. It's a questionnaire. You check off D and C and B and A. You have got to get a score of 90 in the questionnaire or you will not be best qualified, and that's for sure. So here's a sample of a young guy who was an awesome story. His mom hired us to help him with his resume. She wanted him to get a job in the government so bad, and he had a master's in mechanical engineering and two bachelor's degrees, aeronautical engineering and mechanical engineering. And he was applying for GS-9, which, of course, is perfect for a master's degree. So here's, and also he had four internships with Coast Guard in Hawaii where his mom worked. So he had some very good internships. And we added up all the hours and years. And he had 1 year specialized experience as a mechanical engineer and a master's degree. So every day of the week he was qualified for GS-9. Best qualified. So this is a sampling of his questionnaire because his mom wrote me an email and said, I'm so discouraged. Philip is getting nowhere, and I don't know what to do. So I wrote to Philip, and I said, give me your username password. I need to see what's going on with your resume. Your mom's really upset. So I went in there, and I found this. This is a piece of what I found. So number 11. Remember, he's got all those degrees and four internships, so number 11. Solve practical problems by choosing appropriately from a variety of mathematical and statistical techniques. And he says, B, I have the education in this, but I've never yet put that training in practice or performed, or I have done it under minimal supervision. B, on choosing a mathematical statistical technique, are you kidding? That's an E for this guy, because he is the person who is contacted because of his expertise, because a lot of people that work at these U.S. Coast Guard stations, they don't have the degrees in education that he had that he just finished last week. So people probably come to him all the time and ask for his help on how should we deal with this test method here? What statistical method should we use? So that's a B, he said. Number 12, conduct scientific experiments, designing a study, researching a problem, and drawing conclusions. So he says B, again. And all the questions, so let's say there were 10 or 15 questions. He had B or C on all of them. He'd been applying for jobs for, I guess, a year. I looked at his application status, and he had like 100 jobs in there, all of them for which he was best qualified, and all jobs that he could do. But he was shooting himself in the foot day and night with the questionnaire and deflating his answers. So that was keeping him from getting hired. So I wrote his mom a note, and I said, Dear Diane, please tell Philip that if he does not stop deflating his questions and the answers to the questions, he will never get a job in the government. Catherine. So that's about as serious as you can get. So I think she went on downstairs, and she told Philip to quit it and give himself more credit with the questionnaire. Like 1 week later, she wrote me a little G-chat note in the middle of the night. Philip was hired. Philip is hired. He got a job at the Army Corps of Engineers in South Korea, a GS-9 Target 12, a career ladder. And he's headed for a 13, talking about it all the time. His mother's not a 13. She's been with Coast Guard for a long time. And it was a questionnaire, because the resume was fantastic. The resume was off the charts. He was just hurting himself with the questionnaire all the time. So I have a couple questions here. Ann says, thank you. Ted says he's filled out a bunch of questionnaires. Is it important for the resume to directly address the questionnaire? So, yeah, it is, Ted. If you score yourself straight E or E and 2D, something like that, your resume has got to show something about practical problems, statistical methods and techniques, scientific problems, researching problems, drawing conclusions, designing a study. Those words need to go in the resume. Because you can't say you're a perfect person and have your resume not match it, because the HR people have the authority to screen you out if you overstate the questionnaire. Let's see if I have another question here. Almost finished. Okay. Yes, you should change your resume for each application. You saw the resilience resume for Bob. If he was to ask me to help him apply for a work and family life specialist, I wouldn't go crazy with the word resilience. I'd probably go crazy with family counseling, events, coordination, teenager events, something, but not resilience, because the resilience is a different position now, so it's a little bit different than that. So one more question here. Should the keywords from the announcement or the keywords from the description or both? Well, Ted, you know what? If you were to analyze the duties and the specialized experience against the keywords in the questionnaire, it would be the same, because the keywords in the questionnaire are really the same as the KSAs in the announcement. So they're really similar. Myra says, what is the time estimate to revise your resume for different positions? Well, here at the resume place, we take about two and a half hours to analyze a new target announcement and to come up with a new list of keywords, match them into the resume, pop them into the outline format, restructure the paragraphs, come up with a few new sentences to make it realistic. 2.5 hours for each one. But, you know, you don't have to change your resume for every single announcement. If you write a great resume for IT specialist networking, probably, if you apply for another IT specialist networking job, you will not have to change a resume at all. And I know for Justin, the guy that got the job at DHS, we didn't change his resume. He was applying for intelligence analyst jobs all day long, and that resume stayed the same. We did not change it. So it doesn't have to change each time. Shirley says, how do you calculate the score from the questionnaire, D and E, for most of the questions at least? Yeah, you can do your own score on the questionnaire. If you, let's say you have 10 questions and you answer E's for 9 and D for 1, that would give you a score of 90. So you could just get out your calculator and calculate it. And you need to have a score of 90 to get best qualified, because that's usually a cutoff point for most agencies is 90. So try to apply for jobs for which you can say that you are the highest level on the whole questionnaire. Most of the clients that we work with are straight E's, because we do look at the announcement to make sure the person is qualified for it before we charge to write the resume, before we start it, because we only write resumes for people that are really very well qualified for jobs, and we try to get you best qualified. That's what we try to do. I don't say out loud, I guarantee it, but we try very hard for best qualified. Glenn says, I have not completed my degree. Should I include a transcript even if I've not finished it? No, you don't need to include it. They don't care. You can, unless you're applying for accounting jobs, accounting, actually you could. Some of the announcements say that you must have 24 credit hours or 25 credit hours in something. Like with accounting, you have to have 25 accounting technician, 25 credit hours in accounting, budget, finance, or something related to finances. So you should throw it up there no matter what, but if your grades aren't great, you should leave it off. 2.5 and above is okay. Laura says, I heard that where it's normal, resumes are 1 to 2 pages. Federal resumes should be closer to 6. I like the federal resumes to be 5 pages now. I think 6 is too long. I like 5. I feel sorry for the HR people having to read such long resumes. And Ted's got another question. He's really serious. Are cover letters important? No, they're not. They're not important. Unless you have to tell some story about why you want to move from Arizona to Baltimore, or do something, say something that's really critical, because the HR people probably will not read the cover letter because it doesn't go to their qualifications. The manager, if you do get best qualified and referred, the manager might read the letter. So you could write the letter for the manager if you have time. But if you're under a big deadline and you don't have time to do it, I would not worry about it and just go ahead and submit the application that's tweaked for the announcement. So I hope you liked the webinar. I hope that you learned a lot. We write very good resumes here at the Resume Place. Not just very good, awesome, amazing, incredible resumes that are, we apply every single thing here, tips and tricks. These are my favorite points that I like to make when I'm speaking. And I guess my favorite might be the accomplishment one, really. If you don't have a good story in your resume, I think you're not going to compete. I think the story, the accomplishment. We worked on a resume Monday for a big rush, and she's military, just coming out, and she had her Afghanistan story, two of them, or Kuwait and Afghanistan. And the Kuwait job is the one that related to the job. Well, I might have to add her resume into this story, because she didn't have any accomplishments in the resume at all. But by the time we asked her and reminded her all the things she did in Kuwait, I'm telling you, I was so thrilled with what she wrote. If I was a betting person, I swear she'll get an interview, because the accomplishments are so interesting that I think people are going to want to meet her. What she did there in Kuwait for food services and everything was so impressive that it's just going to really get some results. One more question from Ted, and then I'm going to sign off here. He has an academic CV. Is it a good idea to add to the end of my resume? No, do not do that. No. And all of you, if you're recently going to school, our book, The Student's Federal Career Guide, is really good. I highly recommend it, and you can order it from my website. Amazon is out of the books. So write to me an email and order it from me on the Resume Place, and we'll send you the book. So thank you very much, everyone. Have a wonderful evening. Tell your friends about this webinar. I'll be teaching it again next month and others. So come to us if you want a great federal resume. You know where to come, that's for sure, right? And pay attention to these blogs. They are so good. I think they're awesome. Thank you very much, everyone. Talk to you again. Have a great evening wherever you are. Bye-bye.